In this video, I really want to talk about the structure of journal articles. What are they? How are they put together? These things will really help you navigate the scientific literature and to write your own scientific discourse. As always, we begin with scientific epistemology. How does science know what it knows? And we return to this question time and time again because it constrains and structures scientific discourse. So, what are some of the things that scientists use to distinguish between justified belief and mere opinion? Well, one thing that science privileges is the definable. If we can't define the problem, if we can't define the phenomenon, then we can't study it. It doesn't become scientific at that point. Similarly, it has to be something that is observable. If we can't observe it, then there's really no point in calling it science. Along with our observations, we need to be able to make measurement. Science, of course, has lots of ways that it measures things, but if something isn't measurable, it can't be placed under scientific scrutiny. Ideally, what we find in science should be repeatable. If something happens once, we may regard that as interesting, but it's not until we can start to see that phenomenon happen reliably that we begin to have some faith in it. And also, we have to structure our questions in ways that are falsifiable. We hear a lot about hypotheses, and of course, at the core of the scientific method is hypothesis formulation and hypothesis testing. What is often lost in these discussions is that for a hypothesis to be useful, it has to be falsifiable. We can never prove a hypothesis. We can only disprove hypotheses. If our experiments don't disprove the hypothesis, then we say the hypothesis has been supported, but we never, never say that something has been proven in science. Now, of course, for all of this to function on a grand scale, scientific epistemology requires open communication between researchers. And those researchers have to disclose with full transparency what it is that they've done. There's no black box. There should be no secret behind the curtain to how things work. Other scientists have to be able to fully assess it, each individual study, and in order to do that, they need to know exactly how that study was done. Journal articles fit the bill for open, transparent communication, and they are really at the cornerstone of how scientists communicate with one another and how we measure success within the scientific community. They also serve as a record of what it is that we know. And so what are these things called journal articles? Most people have a pretty good sense of what a scientific journal is. It is some sort of publication like Science or Nature or the Journal of the American Medical Association. But these publications publish more than just journal articles. They often have opinion pieces or news releases, or they may have review articles. So, journal articles are their own special thing, and they're a little bit different than everything else that's published. And so, one thing to understand about journal articles is they are primary sources. This means that they come straight from the horse's mouth. They are the first public disclosure of scientific research, as a rule. There are exceptions to that. And they're almost always written by the scientists who did the work. It isn't somebody telling us what some other research group did, it's the research group themselves telling us what they did and what they discovered. Journal articles are peer-reviewed. There are a lot of misunderstandings about the peer review process and what exactly that means. For instance, a lot of people assume that each journal article has been tested by independent researchers, that they've gone in and repeated the experiment themselves. But that's not what peer review is about. Instead, peer review represents a check on any scholar's research. Before a journal article gets published, it first gets sent out to other experts in the field, people who are qualified to evaluate the quality of the study. So one of the reasons we trust journal articles as a source of information, as a form of justified belief, is because we know that it's been checked by other experts in the field. Journal articles are also fully transparent. They're written with sufficient detail that other competent researchers could go in and repeat the experiment if they wanted to. Now, in practice, that doesn't happen very often. However, Even if they don't repeat the experiment, knowing how the experiment was done will allow a researcher to evaluate for themselves whether the results are reasonable and whether the conclusions are justified. Journal articles serve as a permanent record. These aren't leaflets passed out on street corners. These aren't blog entries that can be deleted at will. They are there for posterity. So we can go back and look at journal articles that were written over 100 years ago and assess that work for ourselves. And of course, journal articles have to be readily accessible by the scientific community. If an article is published in an obscure place that I can't access and I can't search, then it's of no use to me whatsoever, and it can't become part of the scientific discussion. So here it's worth our while to pause and reflect about just how successful scientific epistemology has been, and journal articles as the primary tool of documenting and sharing those scientific findings. Recall that if we were to stack all of the information that science had produced by 2007, and we'd put that on CD-ROMs, that stack of CD-ROMs would stretch from the surface of the Earth to the Moon and a quarter of the way back. And that was just in 2007. It's growing daily, so that stack of CD-ROMs is considerably longer today. Of course, when you have lots of information, there's the risk of information overload. How do I find what it is that I'm looking for? How do I retrieve it, and how do I use it? Journal articles, in response to this problem of information overload, have evolved a standardized structure. If you were to go back and look at journal articles that were published in, say, the late 1800s, you'd find no standards whatsoever. Over the course of the early 20th century, and by, I'd say, the 1960s, it becomes a very regular structure. If we uncover this structure, if we look beneath the hood, what we find is what Drs. Gastel and Day call the IMRAD structure. Each journal article will have an introduction, a method section, a results section, and a discussion section. Sometimes these may be rearranged a little bit, but every journal article will have these parts. So if we walk through them just a little bit, the introduction, the first thing it will do is summarize the current scientific understanding of some phenomena. Science is a model-building process, and so science creates models of the way the world works that allows us to make predictions about that phenomenon. The first part of the introduction orients the reader by telling them which scientific model they're engaging with and what that model is. Importantly, the introduction will also highlight a problem with that model. Maybe there's something that it doesn't predict. Perhaps there is a way in which it no longer functions. Maybe new discoveries in the field have put the model into question. Or maybe there's some controversy within the field, some disagreement about how the world really works. If there weren't some kind of problem with the model, if there weren't some kind of gap in our understanding that needed to be filled in, there'd be no need to perform a scientific study at all. And so every introduction will have these two parts. The method section of the paper then explains how the study was done, and it's given in enough detail that a competent researcher could repeat the study if they wanted to. The results section is where the researchers will share with their audience what they found. What facts did the study generate? And finally, we have the discussion section, which is where the authors will explain what they think these facts mean. But it's not just what those facts may mean, it's how those facts change the scientific model. Remember that in the introduction, the authors talk about some way in which the model is flawed, some gap in our understanding that needs to be filled in. In the discussion, they have the opportunity then to discuss whether or not they succeeded in their mission, whether the gap was filled in, or whether or not more work needs to be done. And so often, in addition to explaining how the model may have changed as a result of the findings of the study, they'll very often talk about what work still needs to be done. Now, I want to take a minute to highlight a couple of areas of the IMRAD structure because they're going to be so important for your work on the Capstone Project for VIBS 310. The first is in the introduction. The introduction is often called a literature review, and your capstone project for VIBS 310 is a literature review. And so a literature review is going to always do two things. It's going to summarize the current scientific understanding of some phenomenon, and it's also going to highlight a problem with that model, some gap or flaw that needs to be resolved. Now, trying to figure out on your own what gap exists in the scientific community is a tremendously daunting task, but the discussion sections of the papers you're engaged with make a lot of that work easier for you, because again, they often discuss what work still needs to be done. You don't have to rely on your own understanding of the phenomenon alone. You can also use what others have said to help guide you as you try to create your own literature. So, Drs. Gastel and Day talk about the IMRAD structure, and I like to break that down just a little bit more to emphasize the fact that the introduction does two things. It discusses the current model of that phenomenon, whatever that may be, and it explains the problem with that model. And that's again what you'll be doing for your capstone project in VIBS 310. It then discusses the methods that were used in sufficient detail to replicate the study. It shares what facts and discoveries were made as a result of doing those methods. And finally, there's a discussion of what those results mean, in particular, how they've changed the current model. Does this structure feel familiar to you? I hope it does, because we've just talked about the structure of abstracts. And an abstract contains a background section, followed by the objectives, followed by methods, results, and conclusions. And so the names may be slightly different, but the background information of an abstract orients the readers. And how does it do that? Well, it starts by explaining what model is under investigation. The objective is a statement of what the authors hoped to conclude in the study, which is to say there was some problem with the existing model that they hoped to resolve. The abstract doesn't go into nearly as much detail about the methods. Instead, it just describes what methods were done, but it nevertheless has a methods section. Results, again, are major findings or facts generated by those methods. And here, we called it conclusions, but really the conclusions are putting those facts in context. What do those mean? And so, an abstract is a distillation of the entire journal article. The structure of one is going to mirror the structure of the other. Does it remind you of anything else we've discussed? What about story? You may recall that we've said stories also have regular structure. So all stories begin with a sympathetic character. We get a sense of who that person is and what their world is like. The story doesn't really begin until we get to a complication, some way in which that character's world is made problematic, something that creates difficulty for the character. That character then, as a result of the complication, undergoes a series of actions until they reach resolution. And as a result of going through this process, character or the character's world is changed in some fundamental way. Here, where we had a sympathetic character in a journal article, we're talking about some current model of the universe. The complication of the story is really no different than the problem with the model that's elucidated in the introduction. Where we have actions in the story taken by the character, the researchers perform some set of actions themselves in order to address the problem with the model. In the story, the actions continue until we reach resolution. Well, at the end of the methods that the researchers perform, they come up with some results. And we said again that in story, the character or the character's world is changed. Well, that's what the discussion section of a journal article talks about, is how the model of the world has changed. Journal articles can be elaborate, they're highly stylized, they're full of jargon, which makes them frequently dull and difficult to understand, and frankly, they're very often poorly written. But at their heart, when you break through all of the jargon, when you break through all of that high style, all the sciencey stuff, articles are just stories. They're the stories that scientists tell other scientists, the stories researchers tell other researchers, the stories scholars tell other scholars. Why is that important? Why does it matter that journal articles have the same structure as stories? Well, for a few reasons. One, if you understand the structure of journal articles, you're going to find it much easier to find the information that you're looking for. You don't need to read every journal article this semester from cover to cover, from beginning to end, because the information you need at any given moment is going to be contained within a particular section, and you know which section that information should be in. Also, it's really easy to get lost when reading journal articles, especially when you're just learning about a particular field. And so knowing what the structure is will help get you unstuck, will help prevent you from getting lost. Always ask yourself, if you're unsure about where things are going, go back to these fundamental questions. What is the model that the authors are engaged with? What's the complication? What's the problem with that model? What's the resolution? How has the model changed? If you can return to these questions, it'll make it much easier for you to follow what's going on. Finally, considering journal articles as stories will also make writing scientific articles far less intimidating. If you can see past all of the embellishments, all of the fancy language, all of the jargon, and remember that what it is you're doing is telling a story, well, we are natural-born storytellers. It's our most natural way to communicate with one another. And so remembering that a journal article at its heart is just a story will make telling your own scientific story much, much easier.